वी कैन स्टार्ट
फिर लाइव भी लगा। गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन, जस्ट गिव अस अ मिनट, वी विल वेट फॉर मोर पीपल टू लॉग इन एंड वी विल स्टार्ट दिस डिस्कशन। I think we can start because we have a whole lot of people who've logged in already.
Yes.
So very warm welcome to our speakers and to everyone who is logged in from different parts of the world. Thank you so much for choosing to spend your Sunday evening here with us. It is a matter of great privilege for us at Alap that we have this unique opportunity to play host to Creative Learning, a discussion on the very special occasion of Rukmini Devi's birth anniversary. When Leelaka reached out to us and sounded us off this idea, you know, yet another occasion to honor the memory and the contribution of legendary dancer, choreographer, theosophist, educator, visionary, Rukmini Devi Arundel, we jumped at it. We thought it would be a fantastic opportunity for us also to, you know, listen to some beautiful insights and sharings by a wonderful lineup of speakers who are a part of this discussion. I'd like to introduce them all to you. Sumitra M. Gautama, who's having a little bit of technical issues joining in, but she will be with us any minute, who's an educator, learner, and a dancer. Bombay Jayashree Ramnath, classical musician and music educator. Sheila Shankar, education consultant and teacher of Vedic chanting. Preeti David, journalist, editor, and teacher. And this panel has been very, very thoughtfully curated by Leelaka, who shares a very special rapport with each of the speakers. So I'm very excited to also be a listener and watch this conversation, which is going to unfold as freewheeling, but also very insightful. So over to you, Leelaka. And if any of you has questions at the end of this discussion, please add it to the comments section and we will try and respond to as many as we can, depending on the time that we have. Leelaka, over to you.
Thank you, Akhila. Thank you to Alap for hosting this, and thank you to each of the speakers for spending this evening with us and giving us your time. I'll get straight to the point because I know that education is something that is such a vast subject. We cannot hope to even touch on all the things that we'd like to say and share with the people. But all of you have been, all of us have been students. And we are all blessed to actually be teachers in some capacity today. What I'd like to ask any of you to respond, what quality do you cherish in a teacher? And what is it that you cherish in a student? Jayashree, would you like to start?
Thank you, Akka, for inviting me to this wonderful evening. What I cherish more about me being a student is if my teacher or coach or my guru is able to inspire me to search within to discover more. So he or she, which I've been very fortunate to have, has handheld me to that point where then I can start swimming on my own. And if I were to look for a student, it's the student who ends up teaching me, questioning my approach, expressing doubts over every phrase that I try to sing or attempt to engage the student with.
Yeah, that's so nice. But it's reminding me of something that one of my teachers once said to me, is that there are two ways of learning. One is that you are just a sponge. You let a lot of water soak into you, and you don't stop so much to ask too many questions, but that you allow it to fall over you. And then you spend the rest of your life understanding what was poured on you. The other way is, of course, a very, almost a Western concept where you question at every stage and you ask why before you begin to absorb. You accept only after the theory is proven, if you like. Do you feel that this is an Eastern-Western thing, or is it just a way of, one way of doing it, where you just listen, you don't speak too much, you just accept, and then later you analyze?
I think it's a very Indian thing, Akka, to just accept and absorb. And given that it's so vast and deep, sometimes you fall short of even being able to express what's happening to you at that moment, or for several moments or several hours after a class that I have walked up to a bus stop thinking, trying to remember everything. So I think it's for me, it's a very Indian thing.
Sheila, would you like to talk about this?
Yes, Akka, first thank you and namaste to everybody here and the audience. So what I would like to really do is a little chanting, which all of us probably know, which conveys the answer in a sense to the question that you just asked, which is, Om Sahana Vavatu Sahanau Bhunaktu Sahaviryam Karavavahai Tejasvinavadhitamastu Mavidvishavahai Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. For me, the whole meaning of this chant, where it says, let us be protected together, both the teacher and the student. Let us enjoy this process together. Sahana bhunaktu, together we enjoy this process of teaching and learning. Let us receive the strength to pursue this teaching and learning together. And also let this, all of this lead us to the light, the beautiful light that will appear at the end of this journey together.
Radiant.
So for me, yeah, it is about the bonding. It is about na ma vidvishavahe. Let there not be any misunderstanding between us. Because when, you know, like you said, there is this process that is happening between the teacher and the student. And, you know, there will be questions, there will be answers. Sometimes the teacher can make a mistake. Sometimes the student can, you know, feel that the student knows more than the teacher. So there are all kinds of dynamics at play when this whole process is happening. But how do you keep progressing without, you know, having that misunderstanding and keep continuing that journey? And finally, how it ends is really about, you know, asking for protection for myself, for, you know, protection around my me, which is the environment, and protection between me and that environment. So it kind of, you know, covers everything. And I think for me, that kind of is the association I would make about the qualities that you need in this teaching learning process, or between the teacher and the you know, student, or the educator and the learner.
And you know, in spite of the fact that this is so old, this thought in the shloka that you chanted, yet there's equality between the two persons.
Correct.
No talk of an age difference or a superiority of learning or anything. It's just both are equal. That is such a beautiful thing. Preeti, would you like to come in?
Yeah, thank you, Akka. Thank you for inviting me. This is such an esteemed panel. I'm really honored to be here. So I'd like to approach that question a little bit by asking myself that question, that I really don't see so much of a divide between the teacher and the learner. I mean, having been a student myself, I still feel I'm a student of so many things. And also having been a teacher, I feel that there is really, you know, sometimes there is really no line between the two. As you're teaching, you're learning. As you're learning, you're probably teaching something, you know, unknowingly. And recently somebody asked me, like, you know, can you name 2-3 people who have been the most inspiring? And I looked at my list and they were all teachers. They were all my teachers who had been, you know, the most inspiring. So I really kind of had a little bit of a laugh because I said, here I am, and this is what I obviously treasure the most, was really having being blessed with very good teachers.
Right.
Who allowed me to, who were so passionate about what they did, whether it was Shantatama, who was this great writer and, you know, this great educator, or it was you, Akka, who was so passionate about dancing and about the classical arts, or my English teachers who were so passionate. So I just feel very blessed that I got to taste a little bit of that passion, that abiding passion, which was, you know, they're always interested in what they were doing. They could come to class with so much of excitement, you know, in everything they did, in everything. So I think that that's one of the things that I feel is has really touched me the most about teaching and learning.
And do you feel that that responsibility to bring that passion and excitement to the class resides only in the teacher, or primarily in the teacher, and must be transmitted to the student, or do you expect that? I mean, is there some cynicism in the young today when they come to learn, or do you feel that there's a they're watchful and they're kind of sizing you up? And is that a changed generation, or am I being cynical?
No, I think that there is some truth to that, that a little bit of humility is missing today. Even our teachers were very humble. You know, they didn't feel they knew everything. So, you know, as a student, you imbibe that unconsciously, that there is humility. I feel that today there is a very transactional, there can become a very transactional relationship between the teacher and the student, where it's more about what can you give me, what can I receive? And the relationship is therefore, you know, becomes very different in that way. So this whole idea of passion, humility, love for learning, all that just gets put aside a bit.
Right. Sumitra is unfortunately not yet with us. If you'll agree, I'll move into another question and we'll continue to chat. I hope she will join us, because she's another wealth of information on, you know, things that she's doing at the Pathshala, which is a wonderful new school of the KFI. Each of you have been involved in very, in a way, path-breaking processes, teaching processes, things that were not there when you were a child, perhaps. I'm not sure about this. I mean, there always was. For instance, teaching. As Jayashika, you know, started in a slightly back or an area where children are not exposed, haven't had the gift of being in a city where they're. But all of you, in your own ways, have been innovative, creative, thought out of the box, not adhered to a curricula for that moment sometimes. Could you share with us this journey and what it has actually taught you? You know, because I agree totally with Preeti that when I first went to Delhi, I only wanted to be, I mean, I wanted to dance. I had no intention to actually teach. But when my guru asked me to start a Bharatikala Kendra, I found that I started learning, actually, when I started teaching. So, Jayashika, can you tell us a little about what you've been able to do? I know you've been teaching, of course, music for the longest time, and such beautiful, sensitive singers you brought into the field. But this new work that you've been doing with your students, can you tell us about that and tell us how it has changed you?
Yes, Akka. So there is this very pretty, small, picturesque village called Manjukudi, and it's near Kumbakonam.
Yes.
And I was there for a concert about 8 years ago, organized by the Swami Dayananda Saraswati Educational Trust. And in the morning hours, just a casual interaction with the children in the Tamil medium government school, just engaging them with a Bharatiyar song, led to what is now a 7 years plus initiative of engaging with them through music. So if I look back, Akka, I have had the good fortune of waking up to my father's sadhana, his singing the Omkar day after day, my mother teaching several students all day, which has played a crucial role in shaping not just my music, but also the person I am.
Yeah.
And I have observed and seen it with children who grow up around any art form. Those who learn and train in any art form, the impact, the powerful impact it has in shaping the mind of that child, a lot of sensitivity, niceness, kind of blunting sharp or rough edges in their personality, an eye for beauty in whatever one sees, a creative input in all that he or she does, or some, these are some of the benefits of engaging with art. With the children in Manjukudi, they're already inside a very rich, natural environment.
Wow.
The village is in the Kaveri belt, there's greenery, there's paddy fields, birds chirping, and a wide expanse of blue sky to just stare and wonder at all day, if one wants to. So music adds a new dimension to the already rich environment that they're growing up with. Just a few notes of music and it kind of completely invigorates them, as though this is what they are thirsting for. And most of them come from very disadvantaged backgrounds, but it's amazing to see how inherently artistic they are and to see how just adding a little bit of music to their routine has brought out that tangible little beauty from within them.
Wow.
And to see how sincerely they approach music, the learning of it, how much value they see in it and how they express time and again, realizing that music has made a difference in their lives, in their homes, amongst their friends, in bonding with their team, etc. Now, in engaging with these children, I have come to realize that one needs to approach learning of music a bit differently.
Yeah.
It is very possible for a student such as me, all of us, or as a teacher, to fall into a very comfortable niche of approaching the learning of art. One is the very linear, straight-jacketed approach of the way of learning in classical arts that I have grown up with. And the other is to approach it in a very give and take way, which is equally rewarding. And especially in a place like Manjukudi, where often it's the children that shape the environment they learn in, wow, and even the content they learn in. So what the give and take approach does is it adds that dimension of piquing the child's interest, involvement. It allows them to explore, grow, befriend the art, and have them believe that it is possible for them to be involved in making the art, to be part of the process, making it possible to grow with art. It's lovely, Akka, when at a young age, we are made to feel that the art is coming from within.
Yeah.
And not something outside which we need to perfect, tame, and then bring inside us and then bring it out.
Right.
For example, in Manjukudi, it was a beautiful morning and it was raining and all the children were like enjoying the thunder and the rain. And I just said, let's sing a song on Marai. Let's sing a song on rain. Marai Pati Padalama. And all the double plaited, well-oiled hair and bright eyes, they were so thrilled and they said, Padalam, Padalam. And I hadn't taught them any song on Marai. Then I gave them a simple meter because by then they had done many classes learning jati and saying simple takadimi, thams, yer, yet, all of that. So I said, I will give you a meter, which is takadina taka tarikita, takadina tarikita, something like that. And I said, you have to give me words in Tamil, which they have an inherent feel for Tamil words. something that fits in this meter. And within few minutes, the blackboard was fully dotted with ideas, no space even, all written. One child will come, write something. Another will come, run, write something, and run back. And we set tune for that lovely song. So they were actually part of that, that process. And I just want to recite a few lines of that song that they so beautifully created. It goes like this. Siru siru thuligalai peyididum marai. Chinnanjiru manigalikku pidippadu marai. Azhagana mayilai aadavaippadu marai. Vanna vanna vana villai thondravaippadu marai. And many, many lines. And then we had to choose about 8 because it can't be an andadi, it can't be like 100 lines. So we just chose 8 lines. So they felt they owned the music. They believed that being part of that process was possible. So it was just a very, very few notes that took them to that stage. So I really believe, Akka, that the way they look at being being able to express themselves makes me believe that then music is not, or art is not, entertainment. It is a way they can express themselves. And it's important to keep their interest going, considering there are 300 plus children from age 8 to college goers who attend group classes. And then sometimes they come up and tell me, we want to learn Oriya song or Hindi song. Wow. So we make that possible. And because I feel it provides them then for a window to look into another cultural world, another world of sounds and textures. So I really believe, Akka, that adversity makes the mind ripe for artistic expression. And for me and my students, going closer to their world and trying to build that bridge with music has been so invigorating.
Wow. Did they ever come to you with a song that one of their grandmothers had sung, or which in the village was sung to them when they were children? No. Did they ever bring anything like that to you?
So it's unbelievable to, I mean, for me, that I couldn't believe that these children were the first generation to listen to music of any kind.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. One can't, like you and I can't believe that, right, Akka? So some child would come and say, evening la vandu diya ettum bodhu, when I light the diya in the evening, now I sing and my house is very happy.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, so most of them are first generation school goers, and for most of them, their exposure to music also is like for the first time.
And did the boys feel as though they don't have to do this? And did it?
No, there are boys as well. The ratio, of course, is more girls and less boys. But the boys come up and tell me that they do better in math because they're doing jatis.
Good.
Yeah.
That's very sweet. There's always something for the boys. I think, you know, there's always something, some kutu that the boys.
Yeah.
Actually, I'd like to share with you all a very interesting thing that happened when I was director Kalakshetra. One of the senior most music teachers, Sita Rajanamma, she came to me one day and said, can you make dance, the early Tattadava, can you make it compulsory for all music students? So I was a little taken aback, and I said, you know, I said the opposite is true, that every dance student in Kalakshetra has to learn music by part, but the other way, I'm not sure we'll have to look at it. But we did it. We made it up. And I said, why? And she said, because when the dance students, even though they're not music students, when they come for the exam, their talam and their layam is much better than the music students. Music students, even at the end of the second year, their talam is not sitting correctly. While your students, because they do it with their feet, they beat the teyate with their feet, it's absorbed somehow better in the body. And so we started teaching Tattadava to all the music students. It's quite an interesting thing how you can find something like that and, you know, feel that it's possible to change the way you learn something. Sheila, would you like to share something about what you've been doing? Sumitra, welcome. Welcome to the.
Thanks, Akka. Yeah. So looking back 30 years when I started teaching math to 8th grade students, I had actually very little knowledge about how to transfer what I knew to students. I knew math because I was fresh out of college with a master's degree, and I knew my math, but it was a bit of a struggle to actually put it across to the students in a manner that they would absorb and understand. And along with that, I would constantly worry about, do these students like me? That used to be my bigger worry than actually teaching the math concepts itself to them. And like, what can I do to make them like me? And with that came many ideas. So that was one phase of my life where, this question that constantly came up was, what should I do to make teaching learning, that entire process, enjoyable both for the person who is giving the teaching and who is receiving the teaching? This was a question that that came up constantly, and I started looking at various things. My second phase was where I was a student. I was at the Yoga Mandiram and learning and deeply immersed in Vedic chanting. And it was a very different style of, learning. There was from a place where, students would question you all the time. I went to a place where, you didn't question, you just received. You just held your hands like this and, whatever fell in that, you just absorbed, you practiced. And, all of this, both the contrast, and I would always wonder, when am I going to, actually marry these two things and find a way of actually using it in my life. And then my third phase was when I actually joined an edtech company where I was doing a lot of teacher training programs and working with teachers to share how math can be taught in an interesting way. What can we do to make math less scary? I'm sure like a lot of you will agree with this. A lot of children still go through this. When it's math exam, they'll miraculously fall ill, or they'll have a tummy upset, and that's so. And also, there are a lot of things associated with mathematics. If you just talk to someone and you say you're a mathematician, they say, "Oh my God, I was so bad in mathematics." They don't say they are bad in history or geography or some other subject, but it's always, "I was so bad in mathematics. My son has a doubt, I asked him to go and ask his father." This had to change, this perception about mathematics. So there was a lot of ideas at that time, and we were fortunate to have advisors who would tell us that we should start looking at math as something where students can do math physically. Like you have a biology lab, you have a chemistry lab, you have a physics lab. Why don't we have a math lab? And if you remember, we worked with the Kalakshetra school, and it was really enjoyable because in a classroom we have all kinds of learners. We have learners tactile, who are visual learners, who are auditory learners. So it helps to actually work with all types of learners when you are able to bring in something which is not the usual way of learning mathematics, which is very often just do the problem, recite the tables, then you will be fine. Yes, rigor is important, we all know that, but I think what is also really important is how do we address all types of learners within a classroom. How do we bring in, infuse creativity into learning? Because creativity is not just about, someone can sing or someone can dance, or, you're an artist, something like a characteristic which is very inherent to a rare type of person. It's not just that. Creativity is really about how do you actually embrace something which is ambiguous? How do you actually bring in more flexibility? How do you actually challenge what is the status quo? How do you come up with a new solution when it seemingly it appears that it doesn't exist? So these were some of the things that, you know, we would work together with the educators and trying to, you know, constantly think of this and say that how do we create a classroom where, you know, we can bring in creativity into the curriculum, into the mainstream curriculum, without having to actually build an entire new curriculum where, you know, we have to integrate whether it is art or any other, methodology, but with all the knowledge that is around us. I mean, if you look at every state in India, whether it is the, of that particular state, whether it is the culinary, whether it is the arts from that state, whether it is the crafts, there's so much in that that, you know, you can actually start using a lot of it to teach math. Like, and so for example, you know, I have this beautiful Varli painting. You know, this you can just look at it and say, look at teach about patterns, teach about, you know, how many animals are there in that, how many people are there, what is the ratio of animals to the people in that picture, what are the patterns that are there, what, you know, what type of figures are they? You're using triangles. Are they congruent? Are they, you know, are they oriented different? How do you actually, draw these figures? What kind of paint is used in that? Why did they use this? What is it conveying in terms of the social, background of some of these people? What is the kind of vegetation that is growing? So you can bring in so many different dimensions to,
basically holistic teaching.
Exactly. Yeah. So this is what, you know, was my experience largely trying to, you know, work with teachers, work with students. And I'd say it was very enriching because you had to constantly come up with, you know, ideas, resources, planning. And it's a beautiful experience.
Preeti, can you share with us some of the journeys you've made? I know you were teaching at KFI.
Yeah, so I was a teacher for 10 years. And then when I returned to writing and journalism in particular, I was writing a lot about craft and craftspeople. And it struck me then that while I was doing my documentation of craft, I said, this is such a fabulous learning experience. I mean, this is such a fabulous way to teach young children something. So one of the things that that has happened in today's education system is that, it's history or geography or physics or maths, everything is in a silo, in a little box. But actually, human lives are not lived like that. The Mridanga maker, for example, he knows a bit of physics, he knows a bit of history, his geography defines what he does. So there is so much of interconnectedness. And I thought, why not use these stories to teach children and to sensitize them? So one is you teach them that, you know, human life is interconnected and there's none of these, you know, separate subjects actually exist like that. And secondly, sensitize them to something. What are the different kinds of things that people do? And for example, the milk comes to your table. Do you know how herdsmen take care of their animals? Do you know what happens when it's drought? Do you know the toddy tapper, how many trees he climbs and what is the skill that he has inherited and which, you know, he takes with him every day and which if he doesn't do it well, he'll probably fall on his back and be injured forever. Or if you're passing some, you know, in the village, you're passing somebody who's doing something different. Can I build your curiosity to ask a question? What is that person selling? Where does it come from? How did it arrive here? So that's how this, what I do a lot of now is actually I teach in schools and colleges. I get students, I sensitize them to different kinds of lives and livelihoods that we have in India. And I mean, especially in rural India, because I write for the People's Archive of Rural India. So in rural India, there are all these 700 languages. There are thousands of different crafts and inherited livelihoods. So how can we get our students to appreciate the fact that something which is not in a book is knowledge.
Wow.
You know, I mean, that has been my biggest learning, if you say learning as a teacher, is that how can I convey to them that a farmer has so much of inherited knowledge, it's not in a textbook, but it is still knowledge. And actually, some of the interesting feedback that we've got, of course, from students, it's hugely eye-opening and it's very exciting for them. They go on excursion now and their teachers tell me that every 2 minutes, they're like, Akka, can we write about this person? Can we interview so-and-so? Can we ask him what he's selling? But actually, when I went to a village school in Chhattisgarh, not a village school, it was a government school in Chhattisgarh, and I was sharing the same kind of, you know, information about a pastoralist in Ladakh and, you know, some mridangam makers in Tamil Nadu to potters in somewhere else. These young children at the end, they asked me, they said, ma'am, we never thought anyone would be interested in what happens in our lives.
Oh.
So, you know, that also was a great learning for me that there is a need for them to feel a sense of, like Jayashriyaka was saying, own the art, for them to own what happens in their village as being something of importance.
Yeah.
Something that needs to, is worthy of being shared and as important as something coming out of a textbook.
Right.
So, so that is what actually has really excites me every day. And every time I speak to students, whether they're sixth grade or they're master's students, it's so interesting to see them. You can see the little connections being made and, you know,
yes,
the differences being kind of, you know, smoothened out there between subjects and so on.
Wonderful.
Wonderful.
Actually, this is our problem, is that education is seen to be seen to happen only in a classroom, or it's seen to happen in a big school, or it's seen to happen in better than big schools. The exclusivity and but actually all you need is, to look into the eyes of another person and absorb something.
Yeah. So actually, Akka, exactly what we do, for example, this migration, which happened because of the lockdown.
Yes.
So many of the schools and colleges we've been working with, we had been working on exactly this, talk to a migrant. So, you know, the dhobi in your house, the cook in your house, whatever, the driver, the bus conductor, ask them, where have you come from? And then, you know, you start. So let me tell you a story. Let me find out your story. Let me hear about your life. And in that, the connections are built. Prejudices are, you know, put aside.
True.
Yeah.
I'm so happy that Sumitra is now with us. Sumitra, could you put on your audio, please, and share with us some of the wonderful work that you're doing at the Pathshala, and your particularly your own views on the social social context in which students study, and how you've worked that into the curriculum.
Oh, one of the things that I have deeply valued, Akka, about whether it was my learning in Kalakshetra or my exposure to Krishnamurti, is that, beyond the field of right and wrong, as Rumi would say, there's a field and I'll meet you there. Beyond rich and poor, beyond, those of us, you know, regardless of gender, race, creed, class, you know, there's something in us that keeps us creative, that aspires and learns. So for me, that has been the journey, and that's the journey that I share with the students. And it has not really mattered to me in that sense. I've worked extensively with the state board children across active learning and activity-based learning. I have taken children to contexts where there's a challenge to one's conditioning, one's comfort zone. And it doesn't matter that somebody is rich or poor, that challenge is the opportunity for creativity. And I think learning happens in that untethered space. So for me, there's always been that scope. So for me, whether it's theater, you look at Ball, and you look at forum theater, and there's the opportunity to change. There's the opportunity to transform. your reality and the reality. You know, that's the moment, you know, I don't know if creativity can be ordered or structured. You know, the moment of creativity is when there is courageous challenge.
Yeah.
And for me, that's what, whether I have, in whichever frame I have worked and in whichever frame I have learned to work. And possibly the deepest thing that I have learned as a learner is this, the courage and the freedom to be able to learn.
Right.
And so, yes, Akka. So, and I've seen that in you as well. And I've seen that in Ate. And it's been extraordinary. Yes, thank you.
But Sumi, can you elaborate specifically? Because Pathshala is doing the kind of sharing. I'm not going to talk about teaching anymore. The kind of sharing with the child, the privileged child, of an environment around the school, which becomes part of their learning and part of their living, actually. Can you talk to us about that? Like, I can't put it into words like you would.
Yes, Akka. But you've seen Pathshala being on the executive committee. And one of the things that, you know, it's be the change you want to see. So I think we clean the toilets. We have dry toilets here. We do rota. We work with the non-teaching staff, eat with us. They talk freely. They sit, you know, we all sit mixed on round tables on the floor.
Yeah.
The seniors cook. There's community-oriented work. So I don't know about, you know, see, that's the other thing that I learned very early to question, you know, because this whole notion of privilege,
yes,
is systemically true, but, you know, experientially, perhaps one carries what one carries. So we do, for instance, for the past 5 years now, we've been doing a longitudinal survey wherein children interact with the neighborhood. And they go from house to house. They, you know, they negotiate that time. They negotiate, they work home gardens, they work with the self-help groups, they work with the...
collection. You all have done an amazing collection of seeds, right?
Yes, they collect, yes. We have 21 variety of rice seeds. We have a lady from the Irula community who is the herbal teacher and who's a very, very popular member of the teaching community.
Right.
So we have kashayams, you know, we have kashayams that she makes quite almost every day we've been having over the corona now. I'm part of the reason, sorry, the bad connectivity is because I'm deep in a village and it's very difficult to connect. But yes, so I would say that we have tried to walk the talk.
Yeah.
We human manure is used in the fields. Right. But there is this frame of like one of my students, and you were there for his presentation. One of the questions that he asks is, you know, what does one do with systemic inequity? How does one deal with it for oneself?
Yeah.
What if I don't want to be, you know, the poor little rich boy, you know?
No, I think it's amazing that you've been able to transfer that sensitivity to the young person who spoke, where he actually articulated that and said, I don't want to be this person. That he's become so sensitive to the villages around him, to the children there, to their inability. And he talked a lot in his presentation about don't have the same starting point, that they don't have, they cannot get into that gear shift because of their circumstance. I really found that, even if he is not able to do much about it, because it's such a large country and such inequality, but the fact that he's sensitized, that is something that we must transfer to any privileged child. That sensitivity to be able to understand the other.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yes?
I would agree with you entirely, Akka. I would say that, yes, Akka.
Sumitra, how much of a role of the arts might be responsible in the growth of the feelings of a child, or the mind of a child, or the intellect of a child?
It's not the kind of it's not what I learned at Kalakshetra. It's not, and I'll have to say that.
Yes.
And that's I see that as a limitation. But on the other hand, you know, there's work with mud, there's work with seed.
Absolutely.
There's work with different kinds of art materials. There's some work with theater here. There's we've got a lot of good songs from different movements. Which we sing. I would say that. But what I learned at Kalakshetra perhaps was, where cloth is woven. I learned about an India that I hadn't been exposed to in school and college. And it's an India I valued. And there was nothing romantic about it.
Amazing.
Can I add?
Yes, please, Preeti.
Okay. So I wanted to add, Akka, when you asked about the place of the arts in learning.
Yes.
So I feel very strongly that learning has become so intellectual that perhaps the arts is that one place where it still allows you to learn with your senses.
Yes.
And there's one thing which, instinctive, honing your instinct.
Yes.
Which is something that whether it's music or dance or what little that I know of it, I would say, Akka, at least in your, learning from you, you would so often say this, just go with your instinct. You know, you've taught us the grammar, you've taught us the form, now go with your instinct. And so, it's not like you're thinking with your head. You're allowing your senses to take over and yes. Work. And that comes in writing, that comes in any creative expression, right?
Yes, that's why I asked, because today a very well-known British educationalist actually said that people use their body just to carry this head around. He talked about the whole way that we've developed the head and the intellect is that the body is unimportant to our lives. And we're talking about physical well-being. We're talking about critically emotional well-being. We're talking about even being able to apply what you're learning with the mind. Apply it to your life to make your life a better, happier life. So we're talking about art not as, no, I agree totally with Sumi that art not in terms of the, and none of us here on this forum are posing to be, very high, though we are, Jayashirka, myself, Sumitra, we're all dancers or musicians, but of the classical mold, but this is not what we're talking about. We're talking about art in its to be sensitized to the beauty of a moment, to be sensitized to the beauty of the environment around us, and that means to people who are less privileged and who don't perhaps understand many of the things that we talk about. Would anybody else like to just come in on this or any other about the when we talk about creative learning, is there anything else that you'd like to, Jayashirka, would you like to?
Yeah, of course, Akka. I really want to say this, that when we would come over to yours and to Kalakshetra to rehearse for the concerts that we did together, I remember for days after that, months after that, myself and my students, we would approach art differently after that. It would just be a phrase that you looked at very differently. I mean, maybe we're showing the moon and Chandrama Manaso, or the sun, or how the eyes look at the moon, or something like that. But the aspect that this kind of cross-learning was possible. Yeah. So the way I could find myself getting better, the way I approached music, and when I taught students or engaged with them in music, and in particular the composition that we had dealt with, the way they understood and then they sang it and related to that was completely different. Yeah. So again, it is not straitjacketed. So this doesn't also exist in our system. Learning other form of arts, which are possible for us, but we tend to take it for granted. Why shouldn't musicians learn some art form like dance, or why shouldn't mridangam be taught to vocalists, or instrument taught to dancers, or languages taught to musicians? So much more can happen. It's not that you just learn to sing and perfect that art, because you can never complete perfecting it unless you peep into another art form and look at it through the eyes of like someone like you, the way you showed it to us.
That's so critical. Sometimes when I'm listening to a musician singing a particular one, either Padam Javali or a Kirtanam, which we, you know, are familiar with in the dance world, I just wonder, sometimes I'm just listening to them and I'm saying, if only they knew the full purport of that meaning. Yeah. Some of it is very risque. But they sing it because it's technical, you know. I mean, the sangatis are... And you almost wish that they could enter that world
space,
the way a Malladi brothers understands that sahityam. So this is just but the great musicians of the earlier time, they all sang, whether they were violinists or mridangists, they all knew the kritis. They knew the meanings, they knew the ragas. So this cross-fertilization that we're talking about in today's world, which Preeti has touched upon, Sheila, Jayashaka, you and Sumitra, this is possibly what is missing. And for me, one of the most important things is, does good education or creative learning, sadhana, contemplative learning, does that make you a better human? Because what we want to see is a loving touch in a child. A child who feels empathy for people around them. Do you feel that it leads to a better human being? Sumi?
Yeah. No, what you said threw up so much, Akka, both from here and from Kalakshetra. I was just thinking how many languages I was exposed to in Kalakshetra. Telugu, Malayalam, Tamil, Sanskrit. You know, we had general music, we had, I've just about been, everything. I waved, for instance, a fan for so many people, including, I've been a monkey, I've been a bee, I've been I've been 100 different things. I've been a wave. I don't know. I mean,
everything. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, there's the kind of... Yeah, and I mean, and it's so rich. It's so rich. And when I think about all that, and I think how each day went in that place with all the different things one learned about life and about oneself and about a supple spine. And I remember, Periyasharada teacher, talking about being a patra, being empty.
Empty.
And I was listening to Krishnamurti through that period of time, and I found so much meaning there. Also, I remember Tineshtarada teacher, the adavus, and doing those adavus, I remember there would be no let. And she said, the earth will support you. And one of my most meaningful moments was actually experiencing a moment of floating, actually possibly because of the pain. Also because there was something there that went beyond like and dislike.
Beyond pain. You do it enough times and the pain also stops.
And that's the connect I feel, Akka, with life as I see it now with Krishnamurti. He says the dancer will dance, So, you know, we deal with feelings every day. We deal with people, you know, and there are so many different things their bodies and their minds and their feelings and their faces tell you. And I don't think we are ever not dancing. That's my conclusion as of today.
Of course, the world is dancing. But in this transference of knowledge, if you like, to the child, to be able to share with them things like a pranayama. I mean, it doesn't need to take a class for it. You just have to be able to make them aware that such a thing exists, that they can fill themselves with a little more oxygen, or that they can stretch their arms and feel good about it, you know, really good. That I just feel that sometimes we hesitate, we wait for a class time to do that. But if they could just put their hands up and, you know, leap in the air, that you don't need a moment for that. You just, it just should happen. Because otherwise this period learning, as Sheila said, a period for this, a period for that, without the interconnectedness between all of us and between knowledge systems. And languages, the vernacular languages bring that all to, because they all speak of different nuances and different, is there anything anybody would like to add to this? Please, Sheila.
So, Akka, one of the things that I would like to add here is that as educators, we also carry the responsibility of ensuring that, you know, the next generation will be able to deliver the not yet imagined, because, you know, the future is going to be about, we don't know what, the jobs that we don't even know that exist today. And we have seen that, you know, like the jobs that exist today didn't exist many years ago. So how do we prepare them? And I think in this preparation, both creativity and abstract thinking, these are very essential skills that students have to, you know, should have. And that is something all educators should be able to bring to their classroom. And what are some of these ways, you know, what should we do? And in that, one of the things that's very important to me is that we build a safe and a space which is open, where, you know, we embrace failure, we celebrate things that they don't know about. And I think that is when you start doing that, when you start, you know, making that space a very secure, open space, when there is no judgment, I think, you know, students will come out with ideas, and, you know, they will not be scared anymore to actually, you know, talk about their ideas, present their ideas, share their ideas. And I think this is a very important area where we should, keep in mind when we are talking about, fostering creativity. This is something that I wanted to add.
Absolutely. I want to thank each and every one of you. Jayashekhar, thank you. Sheila, Sumitra, thank you for joining us in spite of being so far away from all of us. Preeti, Akhila, on your behalf and on behalf of with Amma's blessings, today's birth anniversary, she was so keen on building a school, she and Dr. Arundel, in memory of their guru, Dr. Annie Besant, that the Besant School was started much before Kalakshetra, actually. I think many people have missed that fact, that education for a new India was one of their dreams, to bring it back to the open environment, bring it back to an ashram, and not follow any other systems, but to stay with the Indian languages, weaving, spinning, all the things that were beautiful. So, I'm sure she's there to look down upon all of us today. Akhila, thank you. Would you like to?
There are a bunch of questions, Ilaka. Can I just So there's a question from Soumya Kanchit, and she says, how does one inspire the hesitant learner? There are children who are so enormously talented, but hesitate to accept teacher's guidance on art merely out of fear of not living up to the expectations of the teacher or of failure? This is one part of the question. Maybe after you answer, after one of you responds to it or all of you respond to it, I will ask you the second part of the question.
Jayashreeka, would you like to, since it's today?
I can attempt answering that very beautiful question, Akka. I think the approach is what matters. And I always wonder, when we teach music, are we teaching to create only performers or concert artists? Is it about wanting the child to perfect every song and sing in pitch in the next class and kind of learn all the words by heart and all that? Are we not attempting somewhere to create people who can enjoy art for the sake of art? And in that journey, if a child chooses then to pick up that and say, this is going to be my lifetime, I think that's the opportunity we don't create, we fail to understand and appreciate. And that's why then we have children who are scared of things like Sheila said about math, how beautifully she said. And when I listen to Sheila and Sumitra and Preeti, I do want to say that I feel there's so much we've missed. So much in the process of learning that needs to be incorporated and not make the children scared. Yes, the approach has to change.
The hesitant learner can be in any subject, isn't it, Sumi?
Yes.
How do you deal with a hesitant learner? I mean, also because they want to live up to your expectations or the expectations of society or their parents, whoever. As Jayashreeka says, it's all oriented towards passing an exam and then getting that job and entering into some higher space.
Yes, I would say that, you know, it's dealing in images. You know, I think that this is good. I think that this is successful. I think this is winning. I think this is actually having shown everybody, or particularly the people who matter to me or I'm afraid of, that I am okay.
Yeah.
So the challenge always, I think, comes from validating the person for who they are.
Yeah.
And I think allowing something to grow and be in the way that it is, and removing the fear of being wrong.
Also, which many of in your schools they've practiced it is the mixed classes, because when you put people like older brothers and sisters together, I mean, you can do it up to a range. That itself eliminates this thing of having to compete with your own age group, or you could be, you know, helped by somebody who's not necessarily the teacher. I think even in the arts, the mixed groups can work, because somebody who's hesitant is just an observer. They're not performing. They're not even opening their mouth or singing or dancing. I find when they just sit and they watch, somebody else aids them, helps them. And they deal with the senior, with the older, slightly older person who holds their hand and gets them into the class. So the distance between this elderly teacher and that little five-year-old gets, you know, it gets lessened by these other students who are like little older bhaiyas and didis to them. So there are various ways, Akhila, but this would be some.
Could I add a line, Akka, in this?
Yes, yes.
That to add to what you said about MAG, we have junior MAG, then we have senior MAG. I mean, all our classes are mixed age group, like you said. But the other beauty is that learning and you know, someone who can teach doesn't need to be older than you. And I think that where skills are composite, then there's so much that happens that is collaborative and communicates acceptance and acceptability.
Right.
Yeah.
Yes, Akhila.
There is, this question is also again from Soumya. She says, what suggestions would this panel have for overseas children who are stuck with the disadvantages of privileged upbringing?
I think, can I say something? Please. May I say something? I think the first thing about privilege is to recognize that you are privileged. I think that is the biggest journey that many, many students and many of us, even maybe on this panel, to understand that we are privileged to even recognize it has been the biggest step you can take first. Yeah, so that's, I'll leave it to the others to answer.
Yeah, it's for the pair. Yeah, please. Sumitra, would you like to address that?
Yes, what I've found is there are two levels at which this needs to be addressed. I mean, at least I've addressed it. I don't know, there might be, I'm sure there are 100 different ways. I feel that as human beings, I don't think anyone's privileged. I mean, to be arrogant is not really the prerogative of someone who has money, or to be hurtful or to be abusive. You know, I remember somebody bashing into my chest in Mylapore and calling me Brahmanachi, you know. So I don't know if being abusive is really the prerogative of the rich, the problems with gender disappear with privilege. I think at the level of what actually happens with human beings, I've seen that there is no line you can draw. But on the other hand, I do see systemic privilege. I mean, nobody ever thought that I wouldn't study. Yeah. I come from a low middle class background, but I can't think one day that somebody said, education wasn't an issue. I mean, there are so many things. It's habits of being and becoming that are the privilege. The opportunity to dream, the opportunity to be, you know, to accept that you can be, you know, which sometimes, you know, I've gone recently, not recently, 19, you know, in 2019, we were doing this career counseling in some of the schools as prelude to the state career counseling program. And one of the things that I encountered as a stark difference between the children I encountered in my school and the children I encountered there was this fear of opportunity. You know, this sense of timidity with opportunity, you know, saying, who can I, do I, you know, that quality was killing, you know, I mean, I it's very hurtful to see it.
Yeah,
and teaches you about systemic privilege in a way that, I don't know. You peg away at it, I think, at some levels.
Akila, any more questions?
There's a question from Apurva Jeraman Lilaka, and she says, if this is within the ambit of the discussion, what role do any of you can answer this? Do you think that the government can step up and play in terms of arts policy to make arts an integral part of how we educate our younger people? What are the major gaps that exist and how can this be addressed?
If I may just give you a mic to Anna bit before anything else, is that I don't understand why we are so keen to make the government responsible for things like this. I mean, of course, if you want policy change and but having created a policy, it becomes a gigantic thing on our heads. It needs to be, you know, financed, and then we should start the other way. Each of us make the change and let it spread the other way from the center outwards rather than from, I don't understand why in education or art or in anything to do with critical matters like, you know, censorship and things like that, why it has to come from the government down. We as a people have the right to and have the privilege to say no to something. You know, I'm saying if you don't want to watch an X-rated film, don't watch it. The same thing in this matter that Apurva was asking, which is a very important thing. We have to make the change in our own, and all of us actually have the privilege of influencing a large number of people around us. As a mother, as a person who employs a woman in the house, Akila is doing the same. She's got a child, she has a husband, they have friends. So your area of influence must begin from us. If we are more sensitive, I believe we are more sensitive than a monolith government can be. But this is just my take. Please, anybody who would like to talk about this.
Akka, it's what I've seen you do. Being unafraid to question, being unafraid to take your decision and stand there. You know, a supple spine is that, you know. I mean, a supple spine is also a metaphor. A clear voice is not just a song, you know. I mean, you standing there in the face of great pressure, but being able to speak your truth. I mean, what does the government have to do with that? What does anybody have to do with that except who you are?
Yes.
You know? And I've seen you do that. I've seen Atte do that as well. I mean, in her own way, I didn't know her the way I've seen you. But I really deeply appreciate that you've done that. Yeah, I admire you.
We all do.
Thank you.
Yes, we all do.
Akhila, any other questions?
Just one last question, Leelaka. I think we can close with that.
Yes.
That's from Davina, and she says, what ideas, suggestions can you share on how to strike a balance between discipline and fun/creativity?
No, the two are not... I don't know, let somebody else answer this.
So
may I
jump in here?
Yes.
And I would just like to say that as a teacher, when I was a teacher and as a learner all my life, I feel that this distinction that is made that, you know, learning should somehow be fun is something I have a problem with. A lot of learning is not fun, but it's useful. A lot of that, maybe you may call it rigor, you may call it discipline, whatever it is. But life is not all fun. I mean, every day you go to work, you'll have, you know, days in which you have to do really boring stuff. So to give children, to bring them up with this idea that all learning should be just so exciting and so much fun, and if you're not doing it, then there's something your teacher's doing wrong, I think is absolutely the wrong message that we send out today. And
yeah,
as families become more nuclear and, you know, children have become now the focus of everybody's life and energy and so on, I think this has become even more dangerous.
I agree with you. Yeah. Anybody else like to get into that?
I think there's this, you know, I totally, totally endorse what Preeti said. Because I do believe that there is, I mean, that's the ultimate privilege. And I see this, you know, across the board, entertain me, you know.
Yes, yes, yes.
And it's there all the time, you know, you've got to be entertained. And the teacher becomes, a performing monkey, you know, constantly dishing out some new sensation for somebody to. And then there's this pick and choose kind of thing also. And life isn't that, life. The order of life is the creativity of life. So, and that order comes with moving beyond likes and dislikes and sensation. So, I mean, in fact, that's the whole, if there's one thing I've learned, moving away from active performing, I don't know if I've ever done that, but in a way, I feel that this challenge of the sensorial lies in moving beyond the sensorial.
Right.
You know, so I do believe that to truly understand what it is to be alive to oneself in one's body, you have to move away from that which gratifies it and or one's mind or one's emotions. So to be able to look at anger as you would a flower, you know, so
on that philosophical note. Something, a lot to think about. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you, Akka.
Thank you, Akka. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Discussion. Thank you so much, Leelaka, for moderating it and for adding your insights as well. Thank you to each and everyone who shared such beautiful stories, actually. It was so beautiful. We have so many comments from people, acknowledging this session as very enriching. Thank you all. And thank you to everybody who joined in from different parts of the world. We will be uploading this onto our YouTube channel as well, and we will share this link with so many people who could not watch it live on social media. Thank you again, and have a good night, everyone. Good evening, good day. Thank you all. See you soon.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Akka.
Thank you.
Thank you, Akila. Bye, Akka.
Bye.